YouTube. Says, hey, all, I have a question about multi-day races. I'm a Cat 5, and my A race is a three-day stage race in late May comprised of a 38-mile rolling circuit race, a 60-mile road race with varying climbs and a mountaintop finish, and an 11-mile 1% false flat TT. My question is, how should I manage my energy resources in order to maximize my performance? Should I take it easier the first day so I can save for the road race and time trial? Also, since I will undoubtedly be fatigued after the first two stages, how should I adjust my power for the TT if I estimate it to take 28 to 30 minutes? I consider my strength to be 1 minute power, but I still want to do well on all aspects of this race. I estimate to be around 280 watts for an FTP at 64 kilograms, so that's 141 pounds, so 4.375 watts per kilogram. That's strong. In a Cat 5 field, you'll be toward the front, most likely, but you never know. There may be like a 7 watt per kilo junior that shows up and it's just like his presence is regrettable.
Dang.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yes. So he says that that's where he anticipates to be by the time May rolls around for the race. First year on Train Road and love it. So a quick aside for this is he's a Cat 5. So he's not chasing points, but he's chasing a really good performance in this race, right? Because Cat 5, you just need to complete races and you get points. In this case, he's probably going to get 2 points for this race.
Yeah, two mass starts.
Yep. He won't get – you don't get points for individual time trials like this. So so that's out of the way. Instead, we're just talking about a performance. And this one's kind of interesting. So circuit race starts out 38 miles rolling, as then a 60-mile road race the next day with varying climbs and a mountaintop finish. So 11-mile 1% false flat TT is the final one. So that's the sort of TT. I'm going to strangely start with the TT because he said, like, how should I pace with that? When you hear 11-mile 1% like false flat TT at the end of a stage race, Megan, or sorry, forgive me, not Megan, I'm thinking Megan because she was chiming in on this. Amber, what do
Hi, Megan.
What do you think? What comes to mind in terms of how we should pace this, considering it's a false flat at the end of?
That's
going to
be
like
a tough day.
Yeah, right.
Just mentally, it'll be tough, and I think when you're training for, like, if you're training for a TT, like a one-day TT, the sensations that you'll have on that day are very different than the sensations you'll have at the end of a stage race.
Yes.
And this is where, when you're doing your daily training, being really mindful of the sensations, you know, and I think one of the beauty, one of the beautiful benefits of training with power is it helps you to calibrate your own RPE. So understanding, like, what feels like a sustainable effort, is it actually sustainable? And I mean, there are some efforts that you can do that are extremely hard, like VO2 efforts sometimes. One of the things I'll do if I'm doing a VO2 effort outside, I usually try to find a small climb. And I find, you know, I'll do the effort maybe 3-4 minutes hard, and then I look at where my endpoint is, and then I go back to the start. And when you look at from the start of the effort to the endpoint of the effort, that's a really long way.
Yes.
But you're going really hard. So it's that, you know, I always try to remember in, you know, keep that in the back of my mind in a race. Like, I can be going that hard, but I know I can hold it at least for that distance. And it's longer than you kind of think. So little things like that, training those, your awareness of those sensations, what do they mean, reading your body really well. I mean, the art of a TT is getting the most out of your body over a given distance on that day.
Yeah.
Which is really, really hard to train because it's always going to be different. But the way that you do that is tuning into your body and really understanding what those sensations mean for you.
Yeah. That's how you alter things, right? Like, you can come in with a plan, but then you also have to have that plan ready, and then you have to have RPE because who knows, you may also come into it and you may feel strangely fresh that day.
Right.
And you may, even though you have a plan of riding at 200 watts, you may be able to ride the thing at 210.
And maybe you feel terrible and you're not hitting your numbers, but neither is anyone else.
Yes.
And you could have a terrible day by the numbers and potentially still win the race.
Yep.
I mean, it's just, it's really, you know, so that's where the RPE comes in and really knowing your body, I think.
For sure.
For this one, so last week and this week, we talked about setting goals. And I think for any type of race like this, you have to figure out what your goal is and then back out your plan. So, you know, starting with the goal and then, okay, in order to achieve that, you know, breaking that down into the smaller things, what are some of the things I can do? And the TT is definitely a key place where you can gain some time on the field. if the GC is your goal.
Yeah, because that's the thing, right? Like, are you just going to get the experience or like exploit a specific strength to try to get a stage win? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Or are you trying to go for the GC? So like, let's just assume GC is the goal. And this applies to many people listening to this. This is the intent.
Right. Yeah. Well, and you know, for people who aren't familiar with stage races, just briefly, in a stage race, when we say GC, we mean the general classification. So a stage race is a multi-day race. You usually have different types of races. So you have, like in this case, you'll have a circuit race, road race, TT. They can be 2 days, 3 days, 5 days, up to a grand tour. And the general classification is determined by who completes every distance in the shortest amount of time. Mm-hmm. And on the mass start days, if you finish with the group, the whole group gets the same time. Mm-hmm. If you're in a breakaway, then you finish in whatever that time is, less the gap to the field. And then obviously in a TT, it's just your time. So there are some tactics involved in this. So that's the general classification. You can also win a single stage. So you could go for a stage win. And then there are usually some jerseys within there. So there might be a climber's jersey. There might mm-hmm. be a sprinter's jersey. So then the cool thing about stage races, I think, is there are a huge number of options for setting goals.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And if you're going for a stage win and you miss it one day, you can go again the next day. If you're going for the general classification, your strategy is going to be a little bit different than going for a stage win, and definitely different than if you're going for the sprinter's jersey versus the climber's jersey. So they're a lot of fun, I think.
Yeah, it's cool. Like the same field can have a ton of different objectives within that field.
Yeah.
So it makes it a more dynamic experience for everybody.
Yeah, a lot of people are racing different races in the same race, which is exciting.
It's
super
cool because then if you know, okay, that person's going for the sprinter's jersey, there is a sprint line for points, you know, right before this climb. Mm-hmm. So I know that person's going to be stringing it out with their team. Hey, get on their wheels, get in good position for the climb if the sprinter's jersey isn't your goal. I mean, so you can actually really learn and see what other people are doing and play off from other people's strategies.
For sure. Let's get into some GC strategy then in this case.
Cool.
In this case, he has a circuit race, a road race, and then a time trial. Mm-hmm. And I think that you can't, like, it's the order of the races or the stages definitely matters. And in this case, I feel like you can't just save it for the TT mm-mm. unless you had some extraordinary advantage over everybody else. And at 4.375 watts per kilogram, I don't think that would be the case, especially if 1 minute power is the strength that he has.
Yeah.
So in this case, I don't think Nick can just save it for the TT. Because in a lot of stage races, amateur stage races especially, you can kind of do that. Like, mm-hmm. like you can just nail a good TT, and then you can just stick with everybody else for the rest of it, and then you can win.
Yeah.
But in this case, yeah, that could happen. But it's also Cat 5 racing is very unpredictable in terms of the people that are there, the mm-hmm. strength that they'll be able to have one day to the next. Mm-hmm. So it's probably not a scenario where you can just say, save it for the time trial.
Right.
Yeah, and I think not being – there's – this doesn't sound like one of those races where you can just sort of hang out and sit in. Mm-hmm. And especially starting with a fresh, the first day when everybody's fresh in a rolling circuit race, that's 38 miles, which is like exactly long enough to actually shatter some people.
Yeah.
Like you said, if there's fast people, the fast people are going to race that race like they're there to win.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so paying attention to those people is like number one priority is figuring out who the fast people are in your stage race.
Yes.
And then sticking with those said fast people.
Yep.
Right.
And then you'll have to kind of like sit back and look like I stick with them whenever I can. And then I need to capitalize on when I can make time gains. Right.
Right. So again, going back to, okay, the goal is GC, which means that your focus is time.
Yep.
So backing out of that goal, then what are the things that you can do to A, not lose time, and B,
which
gain
is
time,
stick with people,
which is stick with the fast people. So you want to make all of the key selections in the race. And then where is it that you can gain the most time? And I think probably a good rule of thumb in most stage races is you can gain the most time on mountaintop finishes and time trials. Mm-hmm. Whereas like in a crit, it can be really difficult to create that enough of a separation to gain enough time. So on a mountaintop finish, you can easily put in, I mean, if you're a strong climber and you have a strong finish, you're talking minutes.
Yep.
In a crit, it's really hard to get a break up the road that has minutes gap on the field.
Yeah.
So you have to figure out, like to your point, Jonathan, capitalize on those opportunities to gain time. And that has a lot to do with making those key selections and then identifying where do you best use your energy to make those time gains.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's kind of the fun part, especially if you can recon these stages beforehand, that's a huge help.
Oh, yeah.
It's definitely something that I would recommend. So like, let's talk about like the circuit race first in this case, GC's the goal.
Yeah.
Once again, like you said, Amber and Pete, you have to make the key selections, right? Assess the competition, And then it's, you're probably going to find out, like in this case is the first stage, especially with a race profile like this, you're going to figure out who the competition really is and what their strengths are. Mm-hmm. And you're going to discover the unfortunate fact about Cat 5 racing is that it's just like, it is a wide range of athletes, and you will have very fast athletes most likely within very that fast. Group.
Yeah.
So in that case, that's like the circuit race is almost just like stay heads up. Mm-hmm. In terms of Nick's profile as a rider and everything else, I don't think that's the day where he's probably going to make any time gains necessarily, mm-mm. but that's definitely one where he needs to stay heads up and, right. and kind of take everything in.
And right? like Pete said, that's the day to figure out who your competition is. So mm-hmm. if you're staying with the fastest riders, you're not losing time on them, and that's probably the biggest, because the circuit race isn't going to be a good time to gain time, your focus should be don't lose time.
Yes.
So don't put yourself in a hole that you have to make up for in the coming yeah. days.
The road race, I feel like, would be the focus. That's the mm-hmm. next day.
I agree.
So in that regard, you definitely, and since it finishes with the mountaintop finish, recon and figure out that finish. And also, don't ride it in just isolation. I remember doing this with my first, it wasn't technically a stage race. It wasn't my first, yeah, I think it was actually, it was Sea Otter. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't a stage race, but I was doing the circuit race. I was yeah. doing the crit, and mm-hmm. I was doing the road race. Mm-hmm. And I remember like climbing the final road race climb, and all I had time to do was just do that final climb. And it's hard. But mm-hmm. I was like, oh, I got this. It's fine. Yeah.
And then like, that's it?
Yeah, it's easy. And then I came into it at the end of the race, and I was like, I don't know if I can make it up this. Like, so
it's really different.
When you analyze it, try to consider the context of the mm-hmm. race as well. Mm-hmm. So know that you're going to be tired. So like if you just found like you could really sprint up that really steep section, that may be the case, but you're going to have to race differently if that's your plan to really just exploit your 1 minute power toward the end. Mm-hmm. You want to make sure that you are keeping some of that in reserve by trying to ride as efficiently as possible coming into it. Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think this is where psychological warfare comes into play.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. When you're at the end of a race and you're on a climb, it is so hard, and it's so hard for everybody. But you know, everybody's going to, you know, if they're smart, they're going to be keeping a poker face about it. But if you have a 1 minute power, it doesn't necessarily mean that you just need to make your move 1 minute from the finish. Mm-hmm. If you made your move 2 minutes from the finish, putting down that power for a minute might be enough just to demoralize everybody who's with you. And yeah. if they give up on chasing you, that's mm-hmm. all you need. Or even if they hesitate to chase you, that's all you need. So, you know, looking at that finish and picking a few points where you think might be a good place to go tactically based on the terrain, it's good to keep those in mind. And then by the time you get there, hopefully you'll have been paying attention in the race and you'll have a good idea of maybe adjusting some of your strategy on the fly based on what you saw in the race.
And with mountaintop finishes, especially if it's like building up to the steep part for a long time, you cannot get distracted. Yeah. Once again, thinking back to that Sea Otter race, tons of juniors that are just like insane were in that race. I remember them going by me and I was like, no one has ever climbed that fast ever. Not like, not today, not in this, like ever. They're the fastest
this is not
people
really happening.
On a bicycle. It was insane. And then like, you know, 30 seconds later, they were like swerving and like going off the road. So like, yes. you will see that for sure. Mm-hmm. Because there are two points that we basically, when we think bike racing, especially when we start out, we think of two things. We think of sprint finishes and mountaintop finishes, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So when we're in that moment, we get so excited and we...
This is it. This we're is here.
Exactly. I'm a bike racer. Yeah. And we just go. And that's, you really have to stick to your guns. Stick to that plan that you built in terms of analyzing the finish and where you're going to make your move. Mm-hmm. But once again, it's key to mark those GC threats. So if they do make a move, you just have to make sure that you're with them and yeah. then look for that opportunity to use the strength, which in this case, your 1 minute power.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Going into the TT, and then we'll talk about some like recovery stuff and everything else too, but going into the TT, we already talked about this is where RPE comes in because yeah. who knows what the racing has been like the 2 days before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
200 watts might feel really hard now, mm-hmm. right? Whereas before it didn't feel that hard. And this is definitely, and I'm just saying 200 watts arbitrarily, so that's yeah. not like,
right.
we're not saying this is what you should
as
ride
an
at,
example.
Nick.
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then also, this is a key point to understand. Like, this is where your training comes into play. It's like 2 to 3 days deep into a stage race.
Big time.
Because yeah. you're kind of brought down. Everyone's freshness is removed, so to speak. So then at that point, your fitness just is what it is. And if it is higher, it will help you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so this is why you can kind of come into this with confidence if you've been following a structured plan for this, because mm-hmm. you will have a solid backing.
Yeah. And this 1% TT is punishing to people who, if you fall apart, you're going to lose a lot of time.
Yes.
So I would say even err on the side of slightly below your goal pace, because if you do blow up, you're going to, that 1%, you're going to drop 5 miles an hour, you mm-hmm. know?
Absolute negative split, right?
Absolute negative split.
So like you do not want to do your first half faster than your second half.
Build into it. That. Yeah.
Yeah. Cause that will like, you, if it was like a 1% downhill one, that might be a bit different.
Right? Yeah.
That would be
but
fun.
This is, yeah.
We need more of those. <You know?
laughs> Pete, sign me up.
Yeah, I'm a time trialist now.
But yeah, just the little bit of grade, 1% is all it takes. If you go over your limits, then it really starts to punish you. You lose a ton of time. So, so yeah, those are kind of the main things. We didn't have this in our notes really. I guess we do kind of have some tips, but on the recovery side,
mm-hmm.
I think that's like, the big thing. And Amber, you're a professional stage racer. That was what you did.
That sounds really hard.
Yes. Right? Some tips. What would you recommend? First time stage race, most likely, but certainly it's a Cat 5 stage race, so early in a cycling career.
Yeah.
What would you recommend they do off the bike,
Nutrition, 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 nutrition. So eat enough and eat the right stuff at the right times. And honestly, like one of the rules of thumb during a stage race is just never be hungry. Like, mm-hmm. you know, don't, mm-hmm. you know, if you finish the stage and you have your recovery shake, which by the way, please do that after every stage, because it's really, you know, stage race more than any other, you know, especially more than a 1 day race, like it becomes really important to restore those glycogen stores between stages.
Yes.
So getting that recovery shake down, you know, after the ride, super, super important. And then if you have dinner and then you're super hungry half an hour later, have a snack. Like don't, you know, don't stress.
Not this, the time to diet.
No, I'm gonna lose some weight tonight.
No. Like, yeah. Not a good strategy. So the hay is in the barn, guys. Yeah, the hay is in the barn.
Exactly. Yeah.
So I think, you know, always be eating, always be, you know, like really focus on your hydration, really focus on eating, and then know that during the race, when you're taking on nutrition, it's not just about fueling that day, but you're also fueling for the next day.
Yes.
So, and then the second you cross the finish line is the moment you start preparing for the next stage.
Yeah.
So everything that you do from the moment you cross the finish line, from your recovery shake to getting out of your chamois quickly. I had some teammates that had this, the rule of thumb for them was you don't actually start recovering until you've taken a shower.
I like that.
Yeah.
That's good.
Which I think there is like a mental component of it that's true.
It's like switch off when you take the shower.
Yep.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Like, getting, you know, get yourself out of that race venue, get back to the hotel, get back to wherever it is that you're staying, and like really start calming your system mm-hmm. down. That shift from sympathetic to parasympathetic is really, really important.
Can I share something really quick on the nutrition side?
Yes.
Just to make it so that if anybody else has made mistakes like this, we all do them. That same sea otter week, things are not going well. I did the road race, and I remember I got dropped by all these like 7 watt per kilo juniors, and I was like, I clearly weigh too much. Like, I need to lose weight.
I can pinpoint one problem here.
That's all it was. So for dinner that night, I had like a seared ahi plate. It was basically just like some arugula.
And like
And when I mean arugula.
6 pieces of arugula.
Yeah, yeah. When I mean arugula, I mean like
he left garnishes. The other four.
They're like garnishes. And then just like some tuna. And that was like all I ate. And I'm like, I'm going to be so fast tomorrow.
I can't wait for tomorrow. And
I showed up for the circuit race. And I remember after one lap, I was like, what happens? Like, I have nothing in me. So like, yes, everyone does it. We all make that mistake.
Yeah. Learn from our mistakes.
From us. Make sure this is not the time to be thinking. Also, like one thing that I find when I'm in a stage race, if I eat to hunger, I don't eat enough.
Mm-hmm.
Like, but also to that point, like you said, if you do feel hunger, eat for sure.
Yeah.
For me, I always like when I race really hard, my appetite just goes away.
I'm in the same boat.
And mm-hmm. so then like, you know, I do a hard race and then I'm trying to recover and like, I know I need to eat and it's hard and I have to, it's not like forcing yourself to eat necessarily. I guess it is in a way.
Start eating and then it helps a little bit. But nothing sounds good. It doesn't sound like you want to eat mm-hmm. and you just have to start.
Just take
putting
and I take my time
mouth.
With it.
Yep.
I don't try to just like shovel it all in and get it over with. I just take my time, kind of always be eating, so to speak. And
have a plan.
Yeah.
Right. Like, you mm-hmm. know, kind of have an idea of how many gels or packets of blocks or whatever it is that you think that you should want to take in during the race, mm-hmm. you know, and then keep track of how much you actually did. Have a plan for, you know, have that recovery shake ready. Know that you're going to take it right after the race, even if your stomach feels crummy. And then know that, okay, I'm going to have a high carbohydrate dinner. And so at least if you don't feel like eating, you're still sticking to a plan that's going to get you enough fuel to get you through the race.
Sure.
And then, yeah, if you do get hungry, just eat. Mm-hmm. You know, because you need it during a stage race. You really need it. We would get to a point sometimes, like in the longer stage races, some of the like 10 and 12 day stage races. And by the end, like you
don't want to eat anymore.
And it's always pasta. And it's just like, yeah. Oh my God, if I have to look at another plate of pasta. I mean, it would get to the point sometimes where I would like go and find little packets of jam to put in my pasta just to make it different.
Something because different.
It was, I mean, it was. Really gross.
The things
really
that gross. Racers do, you know.
But I had to, I mean, it was really important to get those carbohydrates in, and it mm-hmm. was like the last thing I wanted to do was not eat and get on the bike, and you know that would be a lot worse than just finding sure. a creative way to make the yeah. pasta a little more palatable.
One thing we talked about too is like if you can grocery shop. So you may have a stage race that makes you move like from mm-hmm. one day to mm-hmm. the next, or hopefully you have a stage race that doesn't require that. And even if you do, go big in the grocery store the day before. And
yeah, I mean, the like, day before.
Yeah, and do not do it the day of. Like, get everything sorted the day before. And when I say go big, I mean, like, when you look at the – when you stand there and you're like, I mean, bread and bagels, the answer is yes.
Yes.
Like, don't think, like, which one should I get? Yeah. Get everything, because to that point, it's just, like, things don't sound good or mm-hmm. you're tired of something.
You're going to want options.
And you're going to want options yeah. for sure. So – and get everything that you have – there, and even if you can cook it beforehand, like yeah. Last year when I did the Soho stage race, we went and got a ton of rice, a ton of eggs, ton of chicken, because that was like a really easy, and then like some broccoli and some other stuff like that. But we had our rice and eggs, and we mm-hmm. just like cooked up a bunch of it, and then we had a bowl, and we kept that in the fridge because that was like the first thing that when we got back to the house,
yep.
all six of us racers that were in the house, we just start eating that, and it was easy.
Oh yeah, and it's so nice when you don't have to cook.
Yes, so if yeah. you can pre-cook, yeah. definitely pre-shop. Because it's a pain when you think like, oh, now I have to go to the store to go get X, Y, and Z.
Or go to the restaurant and go sit in the yes. restaurant at a table and order some food.
Yes. Yeah,
not ideal.
That's
not
a terrible idea.
Yes. So, yeah, do that for sure. You also mentioned like alarms.
Using oh, yeah. For it, so we've talked about this before, but, you know, cognitive load is a big thing when it comes to racing. So to your point, like you don't want to finish the race and feel like, oh, man, I got to go to the grocery store and shop for dinner. Because then you're thinking about like making decisions about what to buy. You're making decisions about what you're going to have to cook for dinner that night. You don't want to have to make decisions during a stage race. So plan it out, you know, mm-hmm. plan your meals, do the shopping ahead of time. If you're with a team, or even if you're not with teammates, if you're with a group of people who are sharing maybe an Airbnb or something, do dinners on a rotating schedule. So you plan ahead, you know what night you're cooking, you know what you're going to cook, make sure it's something quick and easy. Mm-hmm. But I really like to use alarms for this stuff. So like I'll set an alarm 3 hours before my race time. That's, you know, eat your pre-race meal. So if that's breakfast, it's breakfast. And then an hour mm-hmm. beforehand, you know, start drinking or whatever the things are that you, or, you know, pin your number. What are the things that you need to remember to do leading up to the race and even after the race? And just set alarms on your phone. I'd have like 15 or 20 in a race day sometimes. And it's just great because you don't have to worry about like, oh, I don't want to forget to, you know, get my number, or, you know, have a packing list of stuff that you need to take with you on the day. So again, like you're not mentally going through a checklist. You actually have a checklist and you know for sure you have everything. You're not second guessing yourself. Just remove all of the decision-making that you can. Do it all ahead of time. And then, yeah, the alarms are great for that.
Yeah, and one thing to kind of like, it seems a simple tip, but the best way to lay out that alarm schedule is to look at your start time and then mm-hmm. just count backwards.
Yeah.
And give yourself a little bit of allowance for everything. And then if you, like, I just do it on my iPhone in the Notes app, I just go, like, start 9 a.m. And then I go, okay, so I'll need to be at the starting line at basically 8:55.
Mm-hmm.
So 8:55, be at starting line. And then I think, okay, well, I'm going to need to warm up before the race. So I'll need 5 minutes to go from my warm up to there. And then I add 5 minutes in and I say, end warm up and then go to there and then start warm up. And I just step mm-hmm. all the way back. And then I have zero stress Like, yeah. You combine that with alarms, and it's just so nice.
Yep.
And because otherwise, you end up, you're like, where's my glove? And then you're like lost, and you can't find anything, and you're stressed. And, yeah, it's a mess. That's the last thing you need in the middle of the stage.
Yeah, and then right? The more you do that, the more you'll develop a pre-race routine, which is really nice, because that it takes even more of the load off, because you just know, like, when you get to the race, you're going to do this. And then after you do that, you're going to do this. And it just becomes, it just becomes habit.
Yeah, 100%. And then also sleeping, right? Oh,
huge.
Like, You honestly, when you're in the middle of a stage race, if you give yourself as many opportunities to sleep as possible, the best night. That's why I try to bring books instead of my phone during stage races,
for sure.
Too, because my phone will just endlessly keep me entertained with useless stuff. And a book, I'll read the book, and then it doesn't, get me so excited in my head, and then as a result, I can fall asleep a whole lot easier.
Books are still awesome, though.
Yeah. Believe it or not.
And they're usually not about the race.
Yeah.
So on your phone, you can just do race things like in this...
Endless loop.
And you don't get to leave it.
Yeah, no.
You're always in it, and it's not... For me, it's not beneficial. Maybe somebody might thrive on that, but I don't.
No.
Yeah.
I'm the same. One of the things you had mentioned before, which I think is important, is the sleep during the stage race is a lot less important than the sleep you get leading into the stage race. So if you're one of those people that has a really hard time falling asleep after a tough day on the bike, don't stress about it. Don't add a layer of stress onto, the lack of sleep. Just, you're going to be fine. Like if you slept well, like the 3 or 4 days leading into the race, you're going to be fine.
Yep. Yep, absolutely. Hey, I'm Jonathan.
And I'm Pete.
And if you like this video, you should subscribe to our channel, because there's a lot more where that came from. And you can give it a thumbs up.
Yeah, if there's something you didn't like, give it a thumbs down. And if you would have done something differently, let us know in the comments below.
Absolutely. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, you should head over to trainerroad.com. It works. That's how Pete's fast.
Yeah, 100%.